The ideas expressed in the following presentations are those of the speakers and do not necessarily reflect the views of ACI or its committees. ACI web sessions are recorded at ACI conventions or other concrete industry events and will be made available for viewing free of charge for 1 week. Thereafter, they will be archived on the ACI website or added to ACI's online CEU program, depending on their content.
Moving on, our next presenter, or our next presentation is up on the screen, and it is again in the general topic of a seismic evaluation of structures. And in this presentation, there's a comparison between ASE 41 techniques and TSPA, which means the Taiwan Earthquake Assessment for Structures methodology. And our presenter today is Dr. In-Sung Kim with Degenkolb Engineers, San Francisco. In-Sung?
All right. Thanks for coming today. As Sergio explained, what I'm going to present today is about seismic evaluation methodology that we have, and also Taiwanese people have, and then compare the seismic evaluation result of actual building damage during the earthquake, and then see how good we are in terms of estimating damages of the buildings during the actual earthquake. So it is very similar kind of idea that ATC 134 is kind of performing right now. And actually, we've kind of contributed all this data from our study to ATC 134. So before I move on, I'd like to kind of introduce like co-authors, like Junwei Lai, myself, Gerald Hagen, Kirk Johnston, Daniel Zapeda. We are all from Degenkolb Engineers. So after this earthquake happens, like 2016 February, Degenkolb sent out five of us for the earthquake reconnaissance, and we investigate these buildings to learn from the earthquake. And while we are there, like Professor Si-Jang Huang at Anchorage helped us a lot to kind of collect this information. Laura already talked about this Mainong earthquake. It was magnitude 6.6. It is around southwest part of Taiwan. And then there were 117 casualties. Actually, more than 100 casualties coming from one building. And it was kind of as an engineer, if you look at the Taiwanese code, it is more like the design level earthquake. So design level earthquake of the current code of Taiwan. So it is not small earthquake, but it is like a 500 Lipton period earthquake for us. So this is kind of just a general overview of the damages that we observed. And when we are at there, we found this district office building. The one building that Laura presented, Danhua District Office Building, is the one of the district buildings. And then this is basically a county office building, like government office building. So they use very similar drawings, and then they are all three stories, concrete frames in one direction, and the other direction is concrete frame with some infill walls. So when we are there, actually we look at four or five of these buildings, and what is interesting is each of building has a different level of damages, and then Taiwanese have a really good ground motion record, so record nearby the building. So we thought this is a really good real world testing specimen, and then see how good we are at estimating these damages using our current seismic evaluation methodology, which is ASE 41. So basic building information there, we looked at the three different buildings, Juzhen, Sangshan, and Guren. And then just for your information, Guren is the building actually seismically retrofitted. If you got this, there is a green wall right there. That's the kind of seismic retrofit they put in this one district office building. The other one did not have a major seismic retrofit, but did not have a major seismic retrofit. So these three buildings basically constructed has a very similar footprint. All of them are about 36 feet high, three stories. And then specified concrete strengths and bar strengths are very similar, actually same. And then they are originally constructed between 1974 and 1984. And after earthquake happens, First two buildings, which was not like seismically retrofitted, they experienced more like damage. We think it is more like the life safety performance between collapse prevention performance level, performance level per ASC 41. And the retrofit building, yeah, it works really well. It was like we thought it's immediate occupancy building. In right now, the first building, the Jujan earthquake, Jujan like district office was retrofitted and still using, and the Sangsan was demolished, and then Guren is like it was in occupied when we were there, and also it is in use without major repair. So this is the footprint of building. And then it is a little bit hard to see, but like basically they use same details like throughout these three buildings. Like it looks like a government has some standard drawings for these government office buildings, and they kind of modified a little bit for each building. So basically they are very similar. And then in terms of a transversal reinforcement, like there are numbers 3 and 6 inches or 10 inches and 6 inches, so they kind of vary over the height. So it is not too bad. Like I saw like worse than this in like in California for the old structures, but still it is not adequate. But one of the big issues, just like Laura pointed out, it is, all of these columns are captive columns, like short columns. So we have like a 2 ground motion recorded nearby these three buildings. The red is kind of where the building is, and the green is where the record station was. And then from this record station, we just select one ground motion. Like I know it is not exact, like maybe we need to do some kind of ground modification from the based on the recording and the distance from the record station, but we didn't go that detail. And then just pick up one record station and create a response spectrum for each direction, and then we learn linear response spectrum analysis and pushover analysis. So I'm showing the linear analysis result, overall result. So just kind of focus on last two columns. So we kind of after learn linear response spectrum analysis, we try to see if this building meets life safety criteria for ASC 41, and then Jujan, Sangsan, they did not meet the life safety criteria. But Guren building, the lateral building, meet the life safety criteria from the linear analysis, and also it meet the life safety performance. So when I'm showing here, I'm showing DCR, which is demand capacity ratio, which means if it is larger than 1, it does not meet the criteria. Smaller than 1, it meet the criteria. And for the collapse prevention performance level, like Jujan building has a DCR of 2.7, and then Sangsan has a DCR of 2.2. So they are not meeting like a collapse prevention criteria as well. So basically, per ASC 41, this building is a collapse vulnerable building after this earthquake happens. But when we are there, I went kind of a three earthquake reconnaissance trip, and then the way kind of I personally think what is the collapse prevention performance versus life safety performance is. Like when I get that building and I'm okay to go in and then do some kind of a survey and then inspection, I would say that means like life safety, which means if there is another like major aftershock comes, it is still kind of it would not collapse at least. But there is a building, when I look at from the outside, if there is a major aftershock happens, then I don't think I'm going to be safe. Then I'm not going there, and I think that is more like a collapse prevention building per ASC 41. So, but anyway, and then we kind of followed by like nonlinear static analysis, which is we call pushover analysis. So just focus on last three columns. So basically, like when you do pushover analysis for ASC 41, you have to calculate the target displacement based on the seismic hazard and the building kind of characteristics. So when we calculate the target displacement, so first column, column number one shows target displacement, and then column number two shows the displacement of this building, like the loop displacement of this building when the first life safety hinge is activated. So that means like a column or beam deforms so much to kind of does not meet the life safety deformation criteria for ASC41. Since ASC41 is like a component-based approach, so we kind of choose whenever one beam or columns are kind of exceeding this performance acceptance criteria, we said like, yeah, that's the way actually total, like all building is, like basically building performance criteria is based on the one performance criteria of just one component. So now it calculate DCR, demand capacity ratio, instead of forces, now it is the demand and capacity is expressed as presented as like a deformation, like displacement. So basically demand divided by capacity when life safety hinge is activated, that is the kind of DCR, like one divided by two. So if you see that like first two district office buildings, like DCR is larger than one, which means it does not meet the criteria, like life safety criteria, even though we use like a nonlinear analysis. And then like the last building, DCR is like 0.19, which is like it meet the life safety criteria. So just looking at each building a little bit more detail, the first building, like Juzhen District Office Building, so this is a little bit hard to see. So the bottom one, the X point, is the what we saw at the building after earthquake. Basically, the damaged column, all these damaged short, like the captive columns, and then wherever we see major shear crack, diagonal shear crack or damage, we kind of put the X's. And then top left one shows like a linear analysis result, and top right shows like a nonlinear analysis result. When you look at linear analysis result, the green is less than one, like a DCR less than one for the life safety performance. Like orange is between one and two, and red is more than two. And for the right side, like green is between IO and LS performance, which means they are yielding, but they are not deformed enough to hit the life safety criteria of ASC41. And then this light blue is like a between life safety and collapse prevention. So actually, light blue does not meet the life safety criteria, and red is collapse prevention, which is collapse prevention or well beyond like life safety performance. So if you look at that, there are basically linear analysis is conservative, but because it kind of shows DCR of two instead of DCR of one point something. But it kind of, in general, like if you're looking ASC41 as not predicting like a building behavior during the earthquake exactly, but like get the idea about whether building is okay or not, it kind of do the reasonable job between like linear and nonlinear analysis, and the linear analysis is somewhat conservative. And the second building, we saw very similar thing, basically the trend is similar, like a linear analysis is more conservative, and then nonlinear analysis is less conservative, but in general, whether building is okay or not, if you, as an engineer, you kind of give a building, it's okay or not, it kind of provided that much information, but does it actually predict the damages? I don't think so, yeah. It's very hard to do that, yeah. And then this is like a retrofitted building. So I don't even show curve because this building did not have a damage. So when we do the linear analysis, life safety DCR was 0.67. And then when we do the nonlinear pushover analysis, like the DCR was 1.19. So that's kind of how conservative a linear analysis is compared to nonlinear analysis. And then even linear analysis, this building meet the life safe IO, like immediate occupancy performance. And then let me switch gear a little bit and talk about a Taiwanese method. So it was very interesting. Taiwan has their own way of evaluating this low-rise concrete buildings because they have a lot of school buildings looks like this building, and they have a government office building. So they have a special procedure, a special method to evaluate these like low-rise concrete buildings has like a captive columns and infill walls and so on. And then, as far as I know, like this is the only thing like successfully adopted like ATC 40 methodology. I might be wrong, but ATC 40 methodology into the like the standard. And then, like basically, they use ATC like a 40 methodology to kind of get the global performance of a building. So they are not really focused on like component performance. They are checking it, but they are not focused on it. But they are like doing more like a global performance. So, like as a practitioner in US, it was a very interesting concept. So basically, they kind of find a performance point, and then using APC 40 method in backward, they calculate the, what is the peak ground acceleration, like equivalent peak ground acceleration corresponding to capacity of a building, and then compare that to the like peak ground acceleration demand, and then calculate the capacity demand ratio, like which is like inverse of demand capacity ratio. So in the end, like when we look at the, their building evaluation report, it is one page just to show like this, like what is the demand, like 0.4 ground, peak ground acceleration is demand, and the capacity is also expressed as a peak ground acceleration. So it's very interesting concept, and it is like a little bit different from what we are doing using ASC 41, but it kind of gives idea about like how they think like building evaluation should be, not component level, but more like the global level. And then this is one of the my last slide. So interestingly, like so, what I try to do here is try to compare ASC 41 pushover curve versus like the Taiwanese method, like a pushover curve. And then yeah, like a black line is out like ASC 41 method, and then gray line is Taiwanese method. So the first thing I realized is like the vacuum curves are very different. And I think Adolfo mentioned it before. I think our, like, and by the way, I kind of checked this thing like a couple of times, more than a couple of times, because if we, when we model like a base shear capacity should be just column capacity, and it shouldn't be that much different. Like there shouldn't be that much different in our like a column strength evaluation equations. So I checked like a couple of times, but we think we did it right. We follow ASC 41 correctly, but there's still like a big difference between black curve and then gray curve. So that's something we have to think about a little bit, because their methodology is really calibrated to this certain type of concrete structure. So their methodology may not be applicable to like the general building, but low rise concrete, non-ductile building. I think their method is very kind of calibrated to that type of modeling, but there is a big difference between just a simple pushover analysis. But in terms of like estimating building, kind of whether building is acceptable or not, like left value shows like Taiwanese method, and ASC 41 shows like our method, demand capacity ratio. Basically, if it's larger than one, they are not passing. If it is lower than one, they are okay. And we are basically getting similar results. If you just look at the building is passing the limit or not, basically Taiwanese method and ASC 41 give us the same result. But in terms of how we kind of model, like evaluate the behavior of building, actually that's kind of very big difference. So we try to find out how we can, where this discrepancy comes from. So we are exploring that right now. With kind of a help from Anchorage. So, summary. So ASC 41 linear method is conservative, but or conservatively identify or like overstressed columns, and ASC 41 nonlinear pushover analysis, nonlinear static analysis, kind of capture the global performance relatively well for all three buildings. Like a linear analysis generally predict higher DCR than nonlinear, which we all know. And both ASC 41 and Taiwanese method provide a reasonable estimation of a building performance. yeah, like a reasonable is very subjective, not like a language, but and significant, there is a significant difference to calculate strength and deformation capacity from like our method and Taiwanese method. So we are going to looking into this a little bit more. So that's it.